Hello everyone, this is Sahithi on behalf of Edureka, and I welcome you to this session on what is Ansible. So thank you all the attendees for joining in today's session. Before we get started, all of you just give me a quick confirmation on the chat window whether I'm audible or not. Okay, I've got many yeses. Alright, so that's great. So now let's get started with the session. So first, let's look into the topics that we're going to cover in today's session. So we'll start the session by understanding what is Ansible and its working. Then I'll talk about configuration management, as Ansible is the tool for configuration management. Once I'm done with that, I'm going to tell you about the pull-based and the push-based approach, and then I'll tell you how to install Ansible. Once you understand how to install Ansible, I'll talk about host inventory, Ansible modules, YAML files, and Ansible playbook, and I'll end the session with the hands-on part. So guys, is the agenda clear to everyone? Okay, so that's great. So now let's get started with the first topic for today's session. That is, what is Ansible? Well, Ansible is a simple open source IT engine which automates the application deployment, intra-service orchestration, cloud provisioning, and many other IT tools. Not only this, but Ansible also is very easy to deploy because it does not use any agents or custom security infrastructures. So Ansible uses Playbook to describe automation jobs, and Playbooks use very simple language, that is the YAML. So what do you think this YAML is? Well, YAML is a human readable data serialization language and is commonly used for configuration files, but it can be also used for many applications where data is also stored. So this means it is very easy for the humans to understand, read and write, isn't it? So the advantage of YAML file is that even the IT infrastructure support guys can read and understand the playbook and debug if needed. So it's basically a really simple language and makes it really easy for the humans to read, write and understand. Now moving on with the session, as Ansible is designed for the multi-tier deployments, Ansible does not manage one system at a time. It models the IT infrastructure by describing all of your systems which are interrelated. So Ansible is completely agentless, which means that Ansible works by connecting your nodes to SSH by default. But if you want any other method for connection like Kerberos, Ansible also gives you that option. So after connecting your nodes, Ansible pushes some small programs called as the Ansible modules, and Ansible runs that modules on your nodes and removes them when they are finished. So it also manages your inventory in simple text files. Those are basically the host files that you can see on the screen, where Ansible uses the host files where one can group the hosts and control the actions on a specified group in the playbooks, right? Next, as I was telling you about Ansible, and Ansible is the tool for configuration management, you should also understand configuration management before you understand how to deploy it with the tools. So talking about configuration management in terms of Ansible means that it maintains the configuration of a product performance by keeping a record and updating detailed information which describes an enterprise hardware and software. So such information typically includes the exact versions and updates that have been applied to install software packages and the locations, and also the network addresses of the hardware devices. So for example, if you want to install the new version of the WebLogic server on all the machines present in your enterprise, it is not feasible for you to manually go and update each and every machine, right? So you can install the WebLogic server in one go on all your machines with the Ansible playbooks and inventory written in most simple way. So all you have to do is that you have to list out the IP addresses of your nodes in the inventory and write a playbook to install the WebLogic server. After that, you have to run the playbook from your control machine, and then it will be installed on all your nodes. So guys, now that you've seen what configuration management is, let me show you how does Ansible work. So basically, Ansible works by connecting your nodes and pushing out small programs called as Ansible modules to them. So Ansible then executes these modules over SSH by default and then removes them when finished. So your library of modules can reside on any one machine, and there are no servers, daemons or databases required. So the management node that you can see on the screen is basically the controlling node which controls the entire execution of the playbook. It's the node from which you're running the installation, and the inventory file provides the list of the host where the Ansible module needs to be run, and the management node does a SSH connection, and then it executes these small modules on the host machine and installs the product. So the beauty of Ansible is that it removes the modules once those are installed, so that it effectively connects to the host machine, and then it executes those instructions, and if it's successfully installed, then it removes the code which was already copied on the host machine and that was which was executed. So guys, that's how Ansible works. Now, if you talk about the features of Ansible, let's take a look at them one by one. So the first is that it is agentless. By agentless, I mean that there's no kind of software or any kind of agent managing your node, unlike Puppet or Chef, where you need to install a Puppet agent or a Chef client on all your node machines. But for Ansible, what you just have to do is you just have to install Ansible in your control machine and then you're good to go. After that, it is built on top of Python, and this helps to provide a lot of functionalities of Python, right? Now coming to SSH, Ansible uses SSH for secure connections. Now SSH is a very simple passwordless network authentication protocol which is very secure. So our responsibility is to just generate a public key in your control machine and copy the same key onto your node machines. So coming to the final feature, the Ansible is also a push-based architecture for sending configurations. So in the case of Ansible where you want to make any kind of configuration changes on your nodes, all you have to do is you just have to write down those configurations and then you just have to push them all at once in your nodes. So if you talk in simple terms, what it does is that it gives you full control on whenever you want to make changes on your nodes and also makes it very easy and fast to set up and needs very minimal requirements. So guys, the features of Ansible are it's agentless, it's built on top of Python, it uses SSH and also uses the push-based architecture. Now, as in the features section, I was talking about that Ansible is a push-based architecture. What do you think is the difference between the push-based architecture and the pull-based architecture? Well, tools like Puppet and Chef are basically pull-based configuration management tools, whereas Ansible is push-based configuration management tool. Now, in the case of Puppet and Chef, their agents present the agent software that Puppet has and is basically called the Puppet agent. And in case of Chef, it is known as the Chef client. So what this agent actually does is that it keeps on pulling the central server periodically for any kind of configuration information. And whatever it finds, it pulls those changes and then gets them affected on your node machines. Whereas in the case of Ansible, since there are no agents present, whenever you want to make any changes, you can make those changes directly and you can push those configurations directly whenever you want to as you've got full control over it. Not only this, but also in a push-based configuration management system. So as you can see on the screen, there's a version control system which manages all the changes in the code base and then we have a server. So basically this server will have Ansible or any other configuration management tool system installed there and then we'll have a bunch of nodes. So these bunch of nodes are basically the collection of web servers and application servers and also the database servers and all these are connected to the main server via SSH. Now, what happens here is that these main servers constantly pull the version control system for any changes in the code base. By this, I mean that it constantly keeps on checking the status of version control system at regular intervals of time. And whenever there are any kind of changes, those specifications are sent to the main server and then the server decides on how to take those configuration changes according to the changes in the code base. Now, in the situation where you want to write all these new configurations, you can directly push them all at once onto your node machines. So you've got full control here and whenever you want to make any changes, you can make the required changes. Now, coming to the pull-based configuration, the relation between the version control system and the central server is the same. It basically constantly pulls for the changes to the version control system for any changes in the code base, and whenever there are changes, it pulls those changes. But the main difference between both the architectures is that from a push-based configuration management tool, it has got an agent present and then this agent or the client is a software that manages all the nodes. So what this agent does is that it constantly pulls the central server for any configuration changes. By this, I mean that it keeps on checking the central server for any changes in the configuration that needs to be made and whenever it finds any kind of configuration changes, it pulls those changes and then only it gets affected onto the node machines. So at this point, you have to wait for an agent to pull those changes and only then the configuration changes will get affected onto your nodes. So the basic point is you have to be a little bit dependent on the agent here and the improvement tools, right? So as I was chanting from the beginning of the session that Ansible is really simple, it's very easy to learn because it gives us the simplicity of push-based system. But there's a disadvantage with the system. That's because you cannot achieve full automation with the push-based system, because it's not usually possible to boot a server and have it configure without some sort of client or server protocol. And also, It gives you a lack of scalability, as well as when you're dealing with hundreds of servers, a push-based system will start showing its limits unless you make use of threading or multiprocessing. Alright guys, so those were the differences between the push-based configuration and the pull-based configuration. So Ansible is basically a push-based configuration management tool. Now moving on with the session, as I've talked so much about Ansible, you would be interested to install it. So how do you think that you can install Ansible? So before I start telling you the steps to install Ansible, let me tell you that there are basically two types of machine when we talk about deployment. Those are the control machine and the remote machines. So the control machines are the machines from where we can manage other machines. And the remote machines are those machines which are handled or controlled by the control machine. So there can be multiple remote machines which are handled by a single control machine. So for managing remote machines, we have to install the Ansible on the control machine. So now let me tell you the steps to install Ansible. So for that, you just have to type in the command sudo apt-get update. So this command will basically update your repositories. Now once that is done, you have to, install the common software properties. So for that, you'll type in the command sudo apt-get install software-properties-common. So you can see that, on the screen that your installation is going on. Now once that is done, you'll type in the command sudo apt-add-repository space ppa colon ansible slash ansible. So this will basically include your Ansible's repository. So you can see a description about Ansible. Now if you want to continue, you just have to press on enter. So once you press on enter, you can see that it is getting continued. Now once this is done, you again have to update your repositories. So for that, type in the command sudo apt-get update. Now once you're done updating your repositories, you have to install Ansible. So for that, you'll type in the command sudo apt-get install Ansible. So this will basically install the Ansible tool. So you can see that your Ansible has been installed. So guys, that's how you can install Ansible. Now let's move on with the session. So now let me just give you a summary of the commands that you need when you install Ansible. You just have to update your repositories. Once you're done with that, you have to install the common software properties. Once that is also done, you'll add a new repository on the name of Ansible, and then you'll update your own repositories, and then finally you'll install Ansible. So these are the commands that you have to use. Now moving on with the session. What do you think this host inventory is? Well, inventory defines a group of hosts which are alike in any way. So for example, you would want to group your web servers in one group and application servers in another, right? So a group can have multiple servers or a single server that can be a part of multiple groups. So the name of the group is enclosed in square brackets, and the server names can be their DNS names or IP addresses. So by default, Ansible looks at the inventory file, but that can be modified by passing the inventory part to the Ansible command line. So we can modify the way Ansible connects to our host by supplying the additional information in the inventory file. So as you can see on the screen, this is just a list of IP addresses on my nodes. And also you can name the groups of your different IP addresses. So for example, if I want to group my web servers together and my data servers together, all I have to do is I have to write a group name between the two square brackets and a big group together. So whenever you want to make configuration changes just on the web server and not on the database server, all you have to do is you just have to mention the group name on the host, and then it will automatically configure your web server. So guys, that was about host inventory. Now if you talk about another key term in Ansible, that is Ansible modules. So modules are those executable plugins that get the real job done. So usually modules can take the key value arguments and run in a customized way depending upon the arguments themselves. So a module can be invoked by command line or can be included in the Ansible playbook. Now let me tell you some commands related to Ansible modules. Now if you want to use the modules from command line, you have to type in the command ansible all-m ping. Now if you want to use the ping module to ping all the hosts defined in the inventory, then you have to type in the command ansible web servers hyphen m command hyphen a ls. So this will basically list all the modules present, and then it will ping. Now if you want to flush IP table rules on all the hosts in the inventory, then you have to type in the command ansible-i inventory all-m command -a IP tables f -bcm -ask -bcm -pass. So this will basically tell Ansible to execute the command with pseudo privileges. So if you want Ansible to gather facts about the host, then you have to type in the command ansible all-m setup. And also, if you want to extract particular facts in the documentation of the setup module, you have to type in the command ansible-doc setup. So guys, these were few commands that you can use with Ansible modules. Now moving on with the session, let me tell you about the YAML files, because that is the file that has been used. So Ansible uses YAML syntax for expressing Ansible playbooks. Ansible uses YAML because it's really simple for humans to understand, read and write when compared to the other data formats like XML or JSON. So every YAML file optionally starts with three hyphens and ends with three dots. So as you can see on the screen here, it starts with three hyphens and ends with three dots. Now, you can also use abbreviation in YAMLs to represent dictionaries. So as you can see on the screen, it basically follows the pattern of a key value pair. So here the key value is James and it has various values like its name, row number, division, sex, everything. So the key James has many values like the name James John, the roll number to be 34, the division to be B, and the sex to be male. Not only this, but we can also represent the list in YAML file. So every element of the list should be written in a new file with the same indentation starting with a hyphen and a space. So for example, as you can see on the screen, after writing countries, we have written America with a hyphen and a space. And then the next value comes in the next line with a hyphen and a space, that is China, similarly Canada and Iceland. So if you have to represent this list in an abbreviation form, it can be represented in the form of countries, colon, and in a square bracket, you can type in America, China, Canada and Iceland, right? Now, further talking about YAML files, you can also represent a list of dictionaries. So YAML uses the pipeline to include new lines while showing multiple lines and uses the greater than symbol to suppress new lines while showing multiple lines. So due to this, we can read and edit large lines, and in both the cases, indentations are ignored. So guys, that was about the YAML files. Now talking about Ansible playbooks, let me tell you how to write an Ansible playbook. But before that, let's see what exactly Ansible playbook is. So as I've told you before, that the playbooks are the files where Ansible code is written, and these are written in the YAML format. So YAML stands for yet another markup language, and playbooks are one of the core features of Ansible and tell Ansible what to execute. So they are like the to-do list for Ansible that contains a list of tasks, and playbooks contains the step which the user wants to execute on a particular machine. So playbooks run sequentially, and playbooks are the building blocks for all the use cases of Ansible. So each playbook is an aggregation of one or more plays in it, and playbooks are structured using the plays. So there can be more than a play inside a playbook, and the function of a play is to map a set of instructions defined against a particular host. So since YAML is a strict type of language, we need to take extra care while writing the YAML files. So now let me tell you how can we create a playbook. So as I mentioned before, YAML starts with three hyphens and then we have different YAML tags. So now let's go through each and every YAML tag. So the different tags that are included are the name, host, vars, and task. So the name tag specifies the name of the Ansible book. So basically I'm talking about as in what this playbook will be doing or any logical name that can be given to this playbook. Coming to the host tag specifies the list of hosts or the host group against which we want to run the task. The host field or tag is mandatory and it tells Ansible on which host to run the listed task. So the task can run on the same machine or on a remote machine, and one can run the task on multiple machines, and hence the host tags can have a group of host entry as well. Coming to the vars tag lets you define the variables which you can use in your playbook, and usage is very similar to the variables in any programming language. Now coming to the final tag, that is the task, all the playbooks should contain tasks or a list of tasks to be executed. So the tasks are the list of actions one needs to perform. So a task field contains the name of the task, and this works as a help text for the user. Well, it's not mandatory, but proves useful in debugging the playbook. So each task internally links to a piece of code called module. Now let's move on to the hands-on part where we'll basically, you know, create a playbook, and then I'll show you the working of Ansible. So let's get started with our hands-on part. So first we have to create an SSH connection, right? to create an SSH connection with the node. So for that, you have to type in the command ssh-keygen. So this will basically, you know, generate your key. So once you type in the command, you can see an output that it is generating a RSA key pair. Now, if you have to mention the directory where you want to store the key, but if you press enter, it will store it at the default location. So let me just press enter. And once you press enter, you can see an output that it has created a directory for SSH. Now you have to enter the passphrase. So for that, let me just press enter again. And again, we have to mention the same passphrase. So for that, let me just mention it again. And you can see that, you know, our key has been generated. All right. Now, once your key has been generated, you have to create a host inventory file. So we're creating a host inventory file so that we mention the specifications of the node IP address that we want to connect with. So for that, you'll type in the command. So for that, you'll type in the command sudo, and then you'll mention the directory of your host. So I've just mentioned the directory, and then I'll press on enter. So it will ask for my password. So I'll mention the password. So as you can see on the screen, this is the default host inventory file. Now, as we have to mention the name of our servers, I'll just mention it in the square brackets. Let's say I mention the name to be test servers. So for that, I'll type in test servers, and then I'll mention the name of the node. So let me just type in the name of the node. So over here, my name of the node is knode. So I've mentioned that. Now, once this is done, just save this file and close this file. So for that, you'll press the keyboard shortcut Ctrl X and then press on Y. So this will save your host inventory file. So once you're done with that, you know, you have to mention the SSH generated key in the knode. That is the node that we just configured, right? So for that, you'll type in the command ssh-copy-id space hyphen I space and the name of the node. So over here, my name of the node is knode. Once I'm done with that, I'll press on enter. And you can see that, you know, it will ask for a confirmation. So let's just say yes. So you can see the output that our key has been copied. Once you're done with that, you'll be asked for your password. So let's just type in the node password. And you can see, you know, your key has been successfully added to your node. Now, before I move forward, I've just cleared my terminal. So just in case if you want to know the command is clear. So once you type in clear, the terminal gets cleared. Now moving on with the hands-on. Now, once your key has been generated, you have to, you know, create a playbook. So before I start creating a playbook, let's just check if our test servers are running or not. So for that, you have to type in the command ansible space hyphen m ping and the name of the server. So here I've given test servers. So I'll just type in that command and then I'll press on enter. Now, once this is done, you can see an output that, you know, it is successful. So now let's start creating playbooks. So to start creating playbooks, you have to first create a YAML file. So for that, you have to type in the command sudo nano. Let's say I give the name to be edureka-demo.yaml. So this opens up a YAML file. Now let's start mentioning the specifications required. So first I'll mention the host. So as I mentioned before, that YAML file starts with three hyphens. So let me just mention three hyphens and then I'll press on enter. So let's start by mentioning the YAML tags. So let's start with the host. So for that, I'll type in hyphen host space colon. I'll mention the name of the server, that is the test servers. Then I'll mention bcm. And over here, you make sure that, you know, you do not miss out the space. So it has to come in one go. And then let's say I put it true. Then I'll mention variables. So for that, I'll type in the command vars. And then you have to make sure that, you know, you're maintaining the syntax. So I'll type in vars, mention a colon. And then inside which, I'll type in ansible hyphen bcm hyphen pass colon to edureka. That is basically our password. Then I'll again mention task colon space colon. And then inside which I'll mention the name. That is basically the name of the task. So for that, I'll type in hyphen name space colon install nginx. And then let's mention the package also. Space colon space pkg is equal to nginx space state is equal to installed. And then I'll put in a space. And then after that, so let me just put in spaces. And then I'll mention notify colon. I'll press on enter. I'll go inside that. I'll mention hyphen start nginx. After that, let's press on enter. And now let's mention the handlers. So for that, let's again maintain the spaces. Space colon, inside which we'll again mention the name. So for that, we'll mention name space colon start space nginx and then mention the service. So that is name nginx state is equal to started. So guys, this was my YAML file to create a playbook. So for that, I'll press the keyboard shortcut Control X and then I'll press on Y. So this will save my file. Now, once you have saved this file, you have to run your playbook. So for that, you'll type in the command Ansible-playbook and the name of the YAML file. So over here, it's Edureka demo. So I'll mention Edureka demo.yaml and then I'll press on enter. So you can see on the screen that the playbook is running. So as you can see, the playbook has run. So basically it mentions name of the server, that is the test servers. It mentions the task. So we wanted to install Nginx, so it has mentioned the task. Then it also mentions the running handler node, that is the K node over here. And then it also mentions whether it is unreachable, failed or not. So guys, this is how playbook runs. Now once the playbook runs, it automatically installs your Nginx container, that is basically the task that we mentioned. Now to check whether it is running on the other node or not, you have to switch to your other node. So let me just switch to my other node. Now to check whether Nginx has been installed or not on the other node, let's type in the command ps vaux, that is waux space pipeline space grep, the name of the file that we install, that is Nginx. Now let's press on enter. So you can see the output that, you know, it has been installed. So guys, that's how Ansible basically works. It's really simple to do, right? So you just have to mention on one node and all the actions will happen on all the other nodes connected to it. So guys, that's all for today's session. I hope you found this session informative. Thank you and have a great day.
I hope you have enjoyed listening to this video. Please be kind enough to like it, and you can comment any of your doubts and queries and we will reply them at the earliest. Do look out for more videos in our playlist and subscribe to Edureka channel to learn more. Happy learning!